you have chosen to be here with us this morning. So welcome to Highland Baptist Church. We have a wonderful day in store for what God is going to be doing in our midst this morning. This is our one-day revival. We are so delighted to have Brother Ray Spence here with us this morning. Ray's been with us a few times in the past, and we've been praying that God would have his way in his church this morning, and that we would continue to see God work in us and through us. Look, before we get going, we want to make sure that you know a few ministry opportunities that are coming up. The Gathering is a special Saturday night worship service once a month, the third Saturday of the month is The Gathering, and that is a worship service geared toward giving people who may work on Sundays or it's difficult to get here for other obligations on Sunday mornings. Then we're opening up this once a month worship service as an option for those folks who either work or it's just difficult to get here on Sunday morning, not because you oversleep, right? Because you have other obligations that keep you from being here. So we're going to give that to people that you know. And so if you have anyone like that in your life, our first one is next Saturday night, and we're looking forward to that. Also, our Holy Week lunches are coming up. Don't forget about those this year. Yours truly will be bringing the devotions each day, and we're going to be going through parts of the book of Mark, looking at the Passion Week through the eyes of Mark on that. And then during Easter, if you're wondering this, we also have just our normal schedule. It is the King of Sundays, but we're still going to have Sunday school in small groups. We're still going to be here for worship, and we hope that you're bringing your family and friends that would love to worship with us. And then also the next week on April 7th, we have our one-day parenting conference that will be during the small group Sunday school hour as well. And that is in the fellowship hall with Dr. Evan Lino leading that. So look, let's turn to God's word as we begin and enter into our worship. If you would, let's stand together as we honor the reading of God's word. Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever and his faithfulness to all generations. Let's pray together. Father, we come before you now with hearts that are full of you and full of your mercy and your grace, Lord. I pray that what you have done this week in our lives and in the lives of your saints here, Lord, that it would spill over in worship, Lord. You alone are worthy of our worship. We are yours. We are the sheep of your pasture. Lord, you are good, you are faithful, you are steadfast in your love, not just to us, but to generation after generation after generation. Lord, we come proclaiming that you are good. We come acknowledging that you are good this morning. And we want to worship you because of who you are and what you have accomplished in the work and the person of your Son, Jesus Christ. May we lift him high. May you build our faith this morning, and may you draw the lost to you. We love you. We give you this time for you and you alone. Lord Jesus, and we all ask this in his name, and all of God's people said,
while you're standing, would you mind worshiping with us as we lift the name of Jesus high and sing At Calvary. Would you lift your voice and sing this morning?
Here's our spent in vanity. Knowing God it was for me, he died at Calvary.
Home. We were a part of great Baptist churches growing up and was familiar with how the Annie Armstrong offering was put to such incredible use.
But growing up in Alabama, it's kind of scary to think that we were going to come out here to try something that we had not done before, that we knew the Lord was calling us to, but didn't want to do it alone.
The context here in Las Vegas is much different than the context in Alabama, and one of that is just religious awareness. 60% of our city would identify with no religion at all. And because of that, I think we have a unique opportunity to introduce them to who Jesus is. It really makes me think of Maki's story. I met Maki for the first time. He showed up at one of our events before we launched called an invite night.
My name is Maki Pizzolo. I'm a professional MMA fighter, which is a professional mixed martial arts fighter. I never thought that God would love a person that fights and looks towards violence for a living. But before Favorite City Church started, Joseph led me to Christ. And I would say that today, my life is blessed. I couldn't even put it into words. My guy is blessing me left and right, bro. And that's legit. I didn't even know church planting was a thing until I met them, but and I'm looking forward to be able to go out and help make more disciples and really turning the tides in people's lives.
Yeah, so now we're in a space where we're seeing over 150 people engaging at our church. We've seen over 30 professions of faith. So the freedom that we get from the Annie Armstrong Easter offering is that we get to engage with people like my friend Maki. We get to take our time, and then that's where we're able to see the disciple-making process happen and the church be born.
Last week we learned just exactly what happens when you give to the Annie Armstrong offering, and this is a prime example. Look at the wonderful things happening in Las Vegas because of people like us that are giving and supporting these missionaries through the Annie Armstrong offering. And so you know what we say. You know what we believe. Give more than you gave last year. That should be your goal. But the bottom line is Christians, people who are unbelievers are coming to are becoming Christians. They're getting baptized and disciples are being made because of people that give money and support that offering. So just like Maki, just like the MMA fighter that you saw whose life was changed in Las Vegas, the name of Jesus was all he needed. He needed to be introduced to the Lord, and he was because of a missionary that followed God's call. So would you stand as we continue to worship and we sing about that name? Isn't the name of Jesus wonderful?
Wonderful. All the world can come to him and have.
name you choose, amen. Now my question is, whose name do you choose, amen? Anyway, what a wonderful time I'm already having. Thank you for having me back, Pastor David. And we're gonna have a good time in the Word this morning. So if you want to, go ahead and open your Bible to the book of John. John chapter 4. Last time I was here, I believe we were in John 3:16. And so now we're gonna be in John chapter 4. So, oftentimes, things happen in life that changes us. And one of those things is a precious bride. And I know that Pastor David is blessed with his precious bride. And sometimes the pastor's wife, you know, she's working in the background, but I love pastor's wives. And if you will help me just letting Miss Rachel know you support her, would you help me do that? Thank you, Brother David, for letting me be here. I pray for you guys most every day. I pray for this church. I pray for your pastor. I take that seriously. You know that from the past. And I hope that you would keep your eyes on Jesus, because there's nothing more than what the old devil would like to do is to knock your feet out from under you, church. So when you keep your eyes on Jesus, it's a solid ground. You just kick him around and you don't even know it, amen? So I want to encourage you to do that today. Well, we're going to journey through this as fast as we can. Don't get nervous. We're going to try to make it through the whole story. But if we don't get there, I'm going to help us get there a little quicker toward the end, okay? So as we exegete through the scripture. But I want to focus on one verse if we can. Verse 39 in chapter 4. Now this will be what we'll read now, and we'll look at this at the end. You've already stood in honor to God's word, so I'm gonna let you rest on that one. But verse 39 says, "And many of the Samaritans of the city believed on him," that's Jesus, "for the saying of the woman was testified, 'He told me everything I've ever done.'" So I want you to pray with me now as we look into what the Word of God is going to tell us today. Would you repeat after me? Just pray with me. Dear Jesus, please speak to my heart today. In the strong name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. In the choir was on fire. Amen. Thank you, my sister. You bless me. So, chapter 4, after John 3:16, some things happen. The disciples are trying to figure out, you know, what do we do? Who do we follow? All this kind of stuff. And chapter 4 comes in, and it gives us so much. I've got like 7 messages on this, counting this one is going to be number 8. But I want you to notice just a couple of things that happen here throughout this message. There are 3 main parts. There's the water, there's the wickedness, and there's the worship. Now, you know, you may say, well, what's the water got to do with it? Well, you're going to figure that one out in just a minute. Now, the end of this chapter, there is the mission. We see the prerequisite, the priority, the place, the position, the proclamation, the purpose, the passion, the persistency, the partnership, being puzzled. Now, I want you to know this, church. The Lord hadn't promised to tell you everything he wants to do. All our job is to show up and follow instructions. Amen? A lot of times we think we need to tell him what needs to happen. He's really not concerned with what you think needs to happen. He's concerned with his plan that he wants to fulfill. I'm not trying to be mean with that. The Lord's not called us to think. You may say, oh, wait a minute, preacher. No, listen, he's called us to obey. Amen? So then we find influence, invitation, incoming, the people coming, and in the insight from the multitude. So as we look at this, I just wanted to plant these words in your mind as we walk through. Verse 1. When therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself baptized not, but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again unto Galilee. And I love this phrase, and he must needs go through Samaria. Now this is where we're gonna spend a little time. Now, I've been reading a lot of the rabbinical laws. I don't know if you've ever looked into all that. Man, it is just like tons and books. Just, it's crazy. And then I began to look into what the Samaritans believed about the Jewish people, because there was a huge problem there, and we'll get to that in a little bit. But Jesus he is the master, and now he's gonna lead the disciples on a journey that they're completely clueless in. They think they're going somewhere, and Jesus has got a plan. And it's not what they think. Now I want you to think about this as a church. You ever thought maybe the Lord has a plan and it's not what you think? Because my question today is, have you been to the well? Have you been to the well, and has your life been radically changed and transformed, and you are not who you used to be, and now you are following the guidance of the Master? Because I think you're going to see a lot of similarity with the disciples in the church of our day, the Western church, let me put it like that. Because the 1040 church, they're dying for Jesus and they're thriving for Jesus, let me tell you. They're getting the job done, folks. And they're not worried about the same things we worry about. Just a thought. Verse 4, I'm just gonna kind of walk through this and just give you questions. I've got other messages on this, and I was just not feeling comfortable with any of them, and the Lord put something else on my heart Friday. Because I had been praying about this, so Lord, what am I gonna preach? Because I don't have a peace about these other messages, and I know I'm supposed to be in chapter 4, and it's Friday. Amen. I'd rather the download come just couple days before I preach, Lord. Amen. Anyway, I want you to think about, are you participating in his plan? Now look at this. Verse 5. Then cometh he to the city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now, how did Jesus get the download? Now you guys know me well enough to know that I just ask simple questions. Well, he knew when to listen. You know, it's amazing to me that we have two ears and one mouth, because I believe we're supposed to listen a lot more than we ask. Amen? That means open up the Word. And as you're going through the Word, say, Lord, what are you telling me in this text? Well, how are you speaking to me? And some of the things, how he's speaking to me, is it's all about relationship. Jesus, when he's walking, you know, in John, and I think I told you guys a couple years ago, I'm studying the book of John half the year, then I'm studying Revelation the other half of the year. My personal time, I've made it to chapter 8. It's taking me 3 years, man. It's been good for me. But you know, one thing I see synonymous is Jesus only did what the Father told him to do. Can you say that? You see, a relationship always leads to a commitment. Y'all know I like to talk about my older days, because when I think of commitment, I think of the commitment that I made to my bride, and I think of the commitment that I made to her, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, sickness and in health, until death do us part. That's commitment. Now, how does your commitment weigh out there with the Lord? For better, for worse, richer, for poorer? You ever thought about it like that? What about this? With commitment always comes discipline. One thing's for sure, men, if you're not dating her, you better get started. Oh, me. That should have been a loud and resounding amen. So we're going to rewind that. I'm going to give you a chance. Okay? She's sitting by you. Men, I'm going to encourage you right now. If you're not dating her already, you need to be doing that. Amen? Oh, there's a few of you got out. Anyway, it's radical. Several years ago, a guy wrote a book about radical. And I'm going to tell you, the things he wrote were already here, and it was already radical. What about this? After you have made commitments, and after you have you're walking in marriage and all this, and you have children, and then you start to disciple your children, right? You start to teach them about the Lord. And as a believer, guess what? You get to go out and live the life before people and in a spiritual kind of way have babies, because people come to know Jesus because they've been around you, because of your influence in their life. And then for the rest of your life, you're loving them and praying for them and discipling them just like they're your own kids. I know that's what's happening because that's what's supposed to, right? You see, we see Jesus doing something that's going to blow their minds. Now, I want you to think about this, about her. Did he know the location she was going to be in? Yes. He knew the exact time she was going to be there. Now think about this. Do you think he's changed? Now that he resides inside of you, do you think that there might be some divine appointments out there for you that he wants to do the same thing he did right here with her? Isn't this amazing? He wants to change people's lives through you. Watch this. God's word continues. And it says, then cometh he to the city of Samaria, which is called Sychar. And we already said this, verse 6. And now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat down at the well, and it was about the sixth hour. Now, we know all this. I know you probably don't know. This is about 12 o'clock. Women aren't supposed to be there. We're not going to go into all that. I just can't help but get caught up in the thoughts about how many missed opportunities happen in just a week. Now, I'm just going to use an abstract number. Let's just say right here in Meridian, Mississippi, there's 200 blood-bought, born-again, man, excited people. They're going out and they miss opportunity. Let's say they just miss one a day. But let's times that by 7. Now somebody help me with the math on that. How many people in just a week are missed opportunities? Somebody help me. Help me. One person, that's 200. Every day, 200 times 7 is what? 1,400. Can you imagine what would happen in Meridian, Mississippi, if just half of us didn't miss it? Do you think he's changed? He has not changed. Is it any tougher to reach Meridian than it was to reach Samaritans? You better believe it. They hated each other. They were both off on their doctrine. They were both off on their beliefs a little bit. They were a little bit right. Sounds like a bunch of churches today. We got a little bit right, but we're forgetting about the main thing. Both the Samaritans and the Jewish people. The Jewish people said, well, you have to worship in Jerusalem. And well, wait a minute, you're a half-breed back from the Assyrians, and we don't even think you can be part of us. The Samaritans will say, well, we're supposed to worship here at the mountain because this is where we're supposed to worship. This is where the sacrifice was made, and it wasn't actually even made there, but this is where we're going to worship. And they had wars about this. And during all these wars and all this stuff, how many lives were being changed? Zero. Be careful that you don't get caught up in things that don't matter. Because how many times have you just really ever thought about, how many churches have you ever seen have the, I think I said this here, how many emergency business meetings have we ever called and said, we haven't had, you know, we haven't had 300 people saved. We got to get together. We got to do something. No. But we'll meet about a bunch of other stuff a lot of times. Be careful. The old devil hasn't changed. What he was doing to the Jewish people and to the Samaritans and causing them to have conflict about something that really didn't matter. And they were missing the main thing. So I want you to think about that. What verse was we on? Anybody remember? Yeah, that's a test for you. Some of you passed. Verse 7. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away unto the city to buy meat. Now, we're going to begin to work into the clueless. Because the disciples were absolutely clueless to what Jesus was doing. You know what? He didn't have to tell them a thing, did he? Because he's master. He didn't have to tell them, well, this is what we're going to do, boys, and this is the to-dos for today. No. You know the reason he told us to go on and get something? Because he knew they were clueless. He knew they weren't getting it. He knew that he's about to open their eyes to something that they could not even conceive of. So he knew you just had to get them out of the way for a little while. You know how we churches, we love to eat, right? they love to eat too. Well, we need to. You got to have nourishment. But I want you to understand something. The Lord's got a plan. He's not asking for you and I to okay it. He's just saying, meet me at the well, and I'm going to show you something different. Watch this. So, the woman's there, and she ask him a question. Basically, I mean, you don't have anything to drink from the next verse, but I'm going to talk to you about that. Did you know that in rabbinical law that the disciples were taught, you're not just supposed to speak to a Samaritan woman because she was unclean? I mean, that was about the same thing as a person with leprosy. Unclean, unclean. And Jesus is going to talk to a Samaritan woman? I mean, these guys have been taught this since they were children. And Jesus is going to speak. He's not even, listen, they weren't even supposed to eat with the same utensils at the same table. You know, they were supposed to remove themselves from being around them. And the Samaritans loved the Jews so much, if they weren't going to Jerusalem and they were coming, you know, into Samaria, they would just kill them. That's how much the Samaritans loved the Jews. And the Jews loved them about that much too. Can you imagine being taught all of your life that this is the way and what we're supposed to do, and it's really not? Can you imagine that? What would happen to a community? What would happen to a region? What would happen to a state? What would happen to a country? Can you imagine this? And this is what was going on right here. Now, there's about to be some Q&A, and there's a whole lot more I could tell you about those the rabbinical laws of that time. I'm telling you, books. So much more detail than I'm sharing with you, but I think you get the picture. So there begins to be a Q&A. Verse 9, wasn't that the verse I was on? Yeah, amen. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou being a Jew ask drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria unclean? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. So this word dealing means absolutely no contact whatsoever. That's a pretty good question she asked. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that say to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. Another question. The woman saith unto him, sir. Now notice there's a change, and this is subtle, but if you go back up to verse 9, she calls him a Jew, basically a Jewish dog. Here, there's a little respect beginning to happen. Sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Now, what she's also saying, like I told you, he wasn't supposed to drink from the same cup as she was, and the Samaritan woman knew that, and she was really trying to help him out because undoubtedly he must be a teacher. Watch this. From whence, and it says it very deep, but verse 12, art thou greater than our father Jacob, and gave us the well, and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give shall never thirst. Now, I want to stop just for a second. The whole time he's talking about spiritual things. The whole time he's trying to let her know that he's the Messiah. Now she gives him a clue. I'm a little bit religious. I know about Jacob. I know about the story about this well. I know about the history. Kind of reminds me of sometimes people in church. We know enough to be dangerous. Watch this. Verse 15. The woman saith unto him, sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Now I think this might be what happens sometimes. You see, there is profession of faith and there's possession of faith. If you go back to John chapter 8, I've been all in that, and there was a great company of Jewish people that said, we're going to believe, and it came down to it, and they said, no, we're not going to believe. We're changing our mind. It reminds me of me. At 9 years old, I came. You know my story. A preacher prayed for me in front of a church. I was baptized. I was dunked. And then my picture was put in front of the church out there. Y'all remember the Polaroids when they came out? I was so proud my picture was in front of the church in a Polaroid. They took it and fanned it, and there it was. Amen. That was amazing back in the mid-70s. I just knew about him, but I didn't possess him. It continues. Now, the woman just asked and said, give me, right? And what verse was that? Right, verse 16, Jesus saith unto her, go call thy husband and come hither. Now, this is where he speaks to help her understand we're all sinners. All of us. So she's, he tells her, well, let's, call your husband. Now, what's amazing about this, Jesus already had read her mail. Friend, he's already read your mail. Do you hear me? He knows who you are. He knows what you think. He knows everything about you. If you're here today, and you know about things of culture, you know about things of church, you know about things of the Western church, and you know about all these things, but have you met Jesus? Have you been to the well? Because he knows. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her. Now, this is wild. Now, later she probably had to go, wow, I thought I could lie my way through. Amen. says, "Thou hast well said, I have no husband, for thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband, and that saidest thou truly." The woman saith unto him, "Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet." Oh, yeah. What would you think? Let's just for a second, let's just say that you've gone to a well and you're sitting there, and I know culturally that doesn't make sense for us a lot of times, and you're there and you're sitting with a guy and he begins to tell you, "You know, I know that you go to church, but you aren't no more following him than you are anything. You haven't been in the Word, and you haven't prayed, and you are just actually doing what your mama taught you to do." And that's not always bad, folks, because my mama, she's a Jesus woman. But mama didn't save me. Jesus did. I'm just sure this woman had to have blown her mind. "I perceive that you're a prophet, and our fathers worshiped in this mountain, and you say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship." Jesus said unto her, "Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what we..." Now, wait a minute, I got to stop right there. Let's talk about worship for a second. What is worship? It's bringing glory to Him. That's what it is. You know, I have worshiped in the stillness of a room, on my knees, on my face, standing up, with my hands raised, with my hands down. I have worshiped with bluegrass. I have worshiped with choir music. It blesses me, thank you. I have worshiped with so many different styles of music. I don't know that worship is a style of music. It's an attitude of your heart. It's surrender. And no matter where you are in life, I mean, I worshiped beside the bed as I was sitting there when Amanda was going to heaven and everybody was singing around us, and I couldn't get words out, but I promise you I was worshiping on the inside. Tears flowing down. I've worshiped with smiles. I've worshiped, you know, in all kinds of places. I've worshiped in Africa. I've worshiped in India. I've worshiped in Brazil. I mean, you know, are you with me? I've worshiped when I couldn't understand any of the music, but I understood this. Jesus was in the house. Something's changing. And Jesus uses the words, "believe me." In other words, listen. And then he tells her, things are going to change and it's not going to be what you think. Then he says, "God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." What is that saying? With a pure heart, with purity. It can't be purity when you're, you know, if you're a drunk, man, I'm just being real. Or it can't be purity if you're looking at porn all the time. It can't be purity if you've got vengeance in your heart toward other people. It can't be purity if you just decided, "Lord, I'm telling you what to do now, and this is what I'm not going to do." That's not purity. Purity is just coming before Him and saying, "Lord, I ain't much." I know it's bad English, but this is good theology. Listen, "I ain't much. But do what you will through me. You have your will and your way." Y'all, all we are is a funnel. I look at life simple. And you know, if you take a funnel, because you don't want to make a mess and you don't want to lose anything. And you put it there and you pour in a liquid substance in, it flows right through. And what's happening, the Word of God every day is funneling in you. And sooner or later, it's going to come out of you like rivers of living water to your family and to your friends and, you know, and into your foes, to even people you don't even like. Their life will be changed because this is proof of this. Samaritans did not like Jews, and Jews did not like Samaritans. And Jesus is about to blow everybody's mind. The woman saith unto him, verse 25, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. And when he is come, he will tell us all things. And Jesus said unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. Now, here's the deal. If somebody just read your mail, your mouth would probably drop, and you're going, yep, you're right. And this is where she is. Huh. You ever been to the well? Have you had this kind of experience with him? I'm not talking about a physical well. I know you all know that, right? Listen, folks. I'm talking about, have you met Jesus? And you realized, he knows everything about me. I'm exposed before him. I can't lie my way out. I can't fake it till I make it. This is where she was. Listen, if you've ever been there, do you realize this? Jesus is everything. Because he should not want us. Do you understand that? Why would he want a liar, a thief? You know, really think about it. Why would he want someone that's going to pretend? That's called grace and mercy, all wrapped up together. Isn't it beautiful? Watch this. Jesus said unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. And upon this came his disciples. Now here we go, the clueless just arriving. I know they had to have had signs, clueless. And marveled that he talked with a woman, that woman. They didn't even say what she was or who she was. Then it says, yet no man said, but Jesus knew their thoughts. And right now, man, he knows your thoughts. He knows what you're really worried about. He knows what you're really concerned about today. And what is that? Is it, I came here today to bring all the glory I could to my Lord? I came here today because it's what he said to do. Y'all remember Jonah? Because I said so? Y'all remember that? Yeah. God's word says, and what seekest thou? Verse 27, it says, why talkest with her? Again, they're puzzled. Why? And all of a sudden, the woman then left. She left her water pot and she went her way into the city, man. And she went to the men. And I believe the men that she went to were the men that she had laid with. And I believe she went to them and said, he knows your name too. You ever wondered about who they were? You ever wondered that? I mean, like, you remember when the Pharisees brought the woman at the well, the woman to Jesus, and they caught her in adultery? Did you know at that time, when you begin to read back in rabbinical writing, you begin to find out that even the Pharisees were sleeping around and doing things? And the guy wasn't there? And so the person that cast the first stone was the person that caught the woman in the act? Oh yeah, everybody dropped their stones. And the disciples are going, what's she doing? Why didn't they want to go to Samaria? Because they were taught not to. They were taught a lie. That's the truth. Anybody remember Rahab? She wasn't a Jew. Uh-oh. Guess they forgot about that one, didn't they? Can I ask you today, what are you doing? What are you doing with your life? And this is as far as we get. This woman, man, we see her faith grow just like that. How did she know to go? And she went back, and I'll just paraphrase, and she began to tell everybody, you got to come see this old boy. He knew everything about me. I'm telling you, he's the Messiah. Come see him. And it was just as though she was compelling them, would be a word. Now, when did Jesus tell her to do that? He didn't. But guess what? He moved in. There's a new ownership right here. And under new management, she just knew, I gotta go tell. She hadn't had CWT. She hadn't had faith. She didn't know how to draw the circles. She didn't know anything about John 3:16. It hadn't been wrote yet. She didn't know the Roman road. But what she did know, this is what he's done for me. Changed her life. So what do we do now? And Scripture's always speaking to three groups of people. First group are those that are saved, that are glorifying his name, and they're saying, yeah, preacher, amen. I already got somebody in mind I'm going to see today. Yeah, preacher, I've got somebody I need to text. I've got somebody I need to Instagram, whatever all the stuff is. Lord's laying them on my heart right now. Don't forget those names. Because just like right here, Lord had a plan to do something. Now look over to verse 39. And many of the Samaritans of the city believed on him, Jesus, for the saying of the disciples. Is that what it says? Somebody help me. What does it say there? For the saying of who? The woman. Now, there's another verse that goes through, and the disciples are going, what in the world's going on? And basically Jesus tells them, I'm fixing to show you something new, boys, because we're going to stick around here for 2 days, and you're going to watch some people get born again. And their culture, everything they've been taught, radically changed right there. Huh. Have you been to the well? There's so much more here, and it addresses so much. This has just dressed me down, if you would. Can you imagine what would happen in Meridian, Mississippi, if just one, you could call this the power of one. I said, you know what? I got the download. I'm not real comfortable going, but I know you're going to speak. The power of one. And what happened in that city? They had a great awakening. That's what we would call it today. Now, can that happen in Meridian? Let me tell you, if it can happen in Samaria, it can happen anywhere. If it can happen with a Jewish Rabbi, we know the Messiah, but Rabbi, visiting Samaria? And Samaritans listen? Oh, it can happen anywhere. So now my next question is, why is it not happening? For the same reason it wasn't here. Disciples just didn't want to go that way. They were clueless. That's strong, I know. But Lord, help me see, Ray. Son, you're being clueless right now, trying to do it your way. Just trust me, son. So I want you to bow your heads with me, if you will. So much the Lord has taught me in this. But one of the greatest truths of this is after this woman was born again, she had miraculous faith just to follow. You've heard me say this, but eternity is too long to be wrong. Listen close. Salvation is not just belonging to church. That's what I did. Salvation is not just being baptized. I did that too, and I was lost. Didn't know Christ. Salvation is not just behaving or doing good. Doing good will keep you out of jail, but trusting Jesus will keep you out of hell. Salvation is not just believing there is a God. You see, this is a text that blows my mind, but James 2:19 reminds us even the demons tremble. There are some people that call themselves Christians that don't even tremble anymore. Because they think they know the way. I don't know anything. I'm just going to be honest with you. I just know Jesus. And I understand this, that he's not asking me to think. He's asking me to obey his word. So I don't get to vote on that. Listen, you may be born again, but you're not trembling anymore. You need to rededicate your life. I'm just being real. You need to just do a restart here. Man, has your computer ever been running slow and somebody said, well, just turn it off, or your internet, and you just unplug it and plug it back in, and man, it all works great. But that's just what needs to happen right now. That's what this day is all about. For Meridian to get reached, you just plug into Jesus and let him worry about the rest. Everything else is small. See, eternity's too long to be wrong. You may ask them, what do I do? I know that I'm not born again, preacher. Well, then you need to whisper to heaven right now. And I can't pray him into your heart just like the preacher couldn't pray him into my heart. But there came a day when I was 18 that I knelt down and asked him to save me. Ask him to forgive me for just being a liar. Ask him to forgive me for trying to fake it till I made it to heaven. Ask him to be my master. Because I understood that much about church. If I was going to surrender to him, it was going to have to be all or nothing. If that's you, this is what I want you to do right now. Just whisper to heaven. And just say, dear Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you are the only way to heaven. I know that you're speaking to me right now. Please forgive me. Please save me. I make you my master, my boss. Now you tell me what to do. That's what that woman did, because we see the evidence in what she did next. Now, if that's you, and you've asked Jesus to save you today, I just want you to lift up your finger for me, because I want to pray for you. Anybody up in the loft,
Anybody, just raise your finger up. Thank you. There's one. Okay, now here on the main floor, anyone? Just lift your finger up. Keep it up so I can see it. Anybody? What about in the choir? Everybody's heads are bowed. Anybody? It's okay. You might be like me. That night, I just couldn't go down front. I didn't know what my parents would think. I thought they would be mad at me. I didn't know what my former youth pastor would think because I really liked him. I thought a lot of him. Didn't know what to do. So I waited. That might be you. I've watched deacons get saved, folks. I've watched staff get saved. I've watched Sunday school teachers get saved. I'm not saying that you're lost if you're all that, but I'm telling you, don't let that hold you in this place. Trust him. Step out there. Do you know that no one got mad at me when I made that public? In fact, there were some older ladies, and they've gone on to be with the Lord now. They prayed for me for many years and sent me cards and letters encouraging me. They said, we were praying for you because we felt like maybe something was missing in your life. And they were weeping when I made that public, and they hugged my neck and they encouraged me. Don't believe the lie. Maybe you need to just rededicate your life. We all need that every so often. I'm just telling you. I need that. I can't come here preaching and without being on fire for him. Friday was that moment for me. I'm being real with you. I said, Lord, I can't go preach. I don't know what's going on. Lord, I don't want to call Pastor David and say, oh, man, I'm not coming, buddy. Something's going on. I just can't get a word. And it's amazing when I sat down and I said, Lord, forgive me for my bitter attitude. Lord, forgive me for being so angry when I'm behind the wheel of my truck. Thinking everybody's got to drive like I think they need to and fussing at them. And Lord, forgive me for doubting you. Please just blow inside of me, breathe inside of me. Lord, I want to feel you like I felt you before. It's amazing what happens when you ask, because he does it. If that's you, do that now. You can put your finger down. I see you. It's okay. You were so sweet. I keep that finger up there that whole time. There's two. Now, just a minute, Brother David's going to come down front. If you raised your finger, I want you to come down and take his hand and say, Brother David, I asked Jesus in my heart this morning, and I know I'm saved. If you have any questions, ask him right there or meet with him later. And maybe you're here and you just need to get a restart. You need to rededicate. Come down, take his hand and say, hey, preacher, today was for me. Would you pray with me? Maybe you just need to come to this altar. You guys know me. I mean, if your kids were overseas and fighting in a war, you'd be on this altar praying for them. If your grandchildren was over there and they were in a heated battle and you knew they may not come out of it alive, you'd be up here. I'll tell you what, there's a battle for souls going on in Meridian, Mississippi. Some of your family and some of your friends are right there on the preface of going to hell. You can come to this altar to pray for them. That doesn't mean you're weak. It means you don't care what people think. In every great awakening, the altars were full. Every time a country was in a low place economically and spiritually, altars were empty. It's up to you. Lord, I thank you for this time. Lord, I thank you for what you've done in my life today. Oh Lord, fall down on this place and do something that can only be explained, that you're here, Jesus. Through your Spirit, you're here and you're working. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Brother David, would you come? Sister, would you come?
Yeah.
would have a seat for just a second. We need to take care of a couple points of business before we leave. First off, thank you for being here this morning with us. Brother Ray, thank you for preaching the word to us. And, you know, he's a big guy, a lot bigger than me, right? But man, the thing that's bigger than Ray is his heart for Jesus and his heart for seeing people come to know him. Amen. And so we thank you so much, brother, for coming and sharing God's word with us. God is working in our folks now, and we look forward to seeing the fruit in the days and weeks ahead from your faithful service this morning. Look, because Brother Ray is a full-time evangelist, the evangelist, according to Ephesians 4:12, is the gift to the church. We're all called to be evangelistic and to share the gospel, but God has gifted his church with the person of the evangelist. And so part of that is he blesses us, he encourages us, he challenges us with God's word, and then God's people help send him and bless him with what God has given to us so that others can continue to hear the gospel. And so we get the opportunity to be generous toward his ministry today. So if you would like to give cash, then you can do that. All of that will go straight to his ministry. If you want to give digitally, you can go to our church app and just click on Love Offering for today, and all of that will be written in one check and given to Brother Ray and his ministry. Or if you just want to write a check, then you can make it out to Impact, I-M-P-A-C-T, Impact, and then he'll be sure to get that, and all of that will go to him today. We want to be generous to you because you've been generous with God's word to us, and so thank you for what you're doing and for the kingdom and for us this morning. So while you're doing that, we need to take care of a real quick vote that we have today. So we're bringing us into a business session. We need to hear a recommendation from the Deacon Counseling Committee. And we had one of our beloved deacons who was called home to serve the Lord, where the Lord is in his presence now. So he's no longer deaconing here, he is deaconing there. And we're we miss Brother Charles like that. And so we're able to see his hopefully replacement today that will continue on that area of service. And so I'm gonna turn it over to our deacon chair.
Good morning. We have met the Deacon Counseling Committee with Mr. Chad West, have vetted him, and he has vetted us. And we come bringing a recommendation from the Deacon Nominating and Deacon Counseling Committee for him to fill that role that Mr. Charles has left us.
All right, since this is coming from one of our committees, we don't need a second, we just need to vote. So all in favor of affirming Chad West's role as a deacon in Highland Baptist Church, would you say amen?
Amen.
All right, are there any opposed? All right, well, Chad is our next servant in the church. Looking forward to how he serves the church and our church body. So look, let's all stand. Again, there's deacons at the exits. Please be generous with your giving toward Brother Ray's ministry. And we again thank him for being here. And thank you for being here. Let me pray, and then let's go out, continue to serve the Lord, to make him known in Lauderdale County. Lord, we love you. We thank you for this time this morning. Thank you for meeting us here this morning. Lord, thank you for your grace and the provision of your word that we fed upon this morning. Lord, I pray that it would propel us into the lives of other people, that we would look for those divine encounters this week, God, that you would give us spiritual eyes to see them, that you would give us the wisdom to know what to say and when to speak, Lord, that you would give us the boldness to open our mouths, because when we stay silent, people stay lost. And we pray that you would use us to bring other people to Christ and to speak about this Jesus who saved us and loves us. And so we've asked that you would go with us, use us this week in this county for your kingdom. Continue to be with our brother Ray Spence as he continues to preach your word, to evangelize in other churches and areas. Lord, continue to pour out your blessing on his ministry and continue to advance your kingdom through his ministry. Lord, we love you. We give you all this time. We give you our hearts. We give you our lives for your service this week. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.